Good evening and welcome to our program. Tonight we'll take a look at Dare County's 911 system. It's being enhanced so that emergency personnel can find your home a little quicker. A bill which gives the insurance commissioner more control over beach and fair insurance plans was approved by the North Carolina Senate and the House of Representatives. We'll have a story about that, and we're going to take a look at the new jail here in Dare County. All that and more when we return in a moment.
When I came here in 1947, I had never seen the ocean, never tasted shrimp, oysters, clams, crab, flounder, never caught a bluefish. And there was a place on the beach, Owens. We used to go there and load up on all that good stuff. So I go back a long ways with them. I lived in the Owens house for 2 summers, wrote my first monologue in their backyard. And I used to enjoy going to their restaurant and eating that fine food. And you know what? I still do.
Northeastern Protection Service has been providing security officers, private investigators, and fire and burglar alarm systems since 1982. They've now expanded their services to include a new retail outlet featuring OSHA-required safety equipment and supplies for police, fire, and rescue personnel and volunteers. Northeastern Protection will beat almost any deal on lights, ammo, and the supplies you need now. Visit their new location across from Midway, Texaco, or call 473-5551. Locally owned, Northeastern Protection, a respected name for a decade.
Mateo Furniture Company in downtown Mateo is more than just your number one choice for home furnishings, because you'll also find Berbers and Salem Carpet, Mannington and Armstrong floor coverings for your home or office. Lori, an interior designer, will assist you with coordination and decorating ideas. They also carry Zenith and Sylvania TVs and VCRs, GE and RCA appliances, and factory-trained service departments. Mateo Furniture will even pick up your TV and return it when repaired. Several reasons why Mateo Furniture is still your number one choice for home furnishings and more.
When you have an emergency, one of the most important things is that you be able to tell emergency personnel where you're located. Dare County is enhancing their 911 system so that it makes that job a little easier. Don Ray tells us more.
Dare Central, Station 13, Station 14, Station 12.
If you have an emergency and you need police, fire, or rescue, you know to dial 911. Now you get an emergency dispatcher at Dare Central, and then the proper emergency service is sent to your aid immediately. But you have to know where you are, what town you're in, and the phone number you're calling from, in case you get disconnected. Soon, all that will change, as Tom Gray, Director of Management Information for Dare County, tells us.
Dare County started looking and researching the capabilities of putting in an enhanced 911 system in the early fall of 1991. In 1992, we made a proposal to the Dare County Board of Commissioners, which was approved in the March 9th meeting, for an enhanced 911 system for the people in Dare County. This was to be funded by a $1 per month surcharge on all telephone bills in Dare County. This funding is authorized by General Statute 62A, the North Carolina General Statutes. The basic difference between a basic 911 and enhanced 911 is the fact that basic 911 does nothing except intercept your call and automatically forward it to the dispatcher. Enhanced 911 is exactly what it says, it is enhanced. Enhanced 911 allows the dispatcher to automatically know when she picks up the phone the name, the address of the person making the call, any prior calls that have been made from that address, any medical conditions existing at that address that has been sent in to Dare County.
When enhanced 911 is in operation in Dare County, the chance of saving property and lives will be much greater due to the information being received immediately. Lieutenant Dave Cowan, Communications Supervisor for Dare County Sheriff's Office, explains.
Along with the enhanced 911 system, we'll also be adopting a computer-aided dispatch system. All of our emergency calls will be recorded on a computer. Right now, that system is performed using cards that are manually, the data is manually entered on the cards. Oftentimes, it's just notes. It's an awkward storage system and a difficult to retrieve data once it's been filed away. A computer-aided dispatch will give us historical data of all calls.
The $1 per month surcharge on your phone bill seems to be quite a bargain compared to the lives that could be saved.
1321, be advised, all people are out of the structure at this time.
I'm Don Ray reporting.
A rule that would require commercial fishermen to stay within 100 yards of their gill nets when they're being used was recently rejected by the North Carolina Marine Fisheries Council. However, the director, William Hogarth, put the proclamation into effect anyway. Joey Daniels, the president of the North Carolina Fisheries Association, spoke with us about the new rule.
I think it's going to have an impact on the small gill netters in the sands and estuaries of North Carolina. It seems to be the rule right now is not intended to hurt the flounder fishermen because they're using a little larger gill net size nets. But the other people that fish for trout and blues will be hurt and we have loss of income due to these new rules and regulations.
We also spoke with James Fletcher, the director of the United National Fishermen's Association.
One, is it good for the resource? Two, is it good for the fishing industry? Three, is it good for the man on deck? And four, is it good for the consumer? The recent regulation that meets none of the four above criteria. The question that we ask is, one, what is marine fisheries doing about chlorine in the water? Two, what is marine fisheries doing about acid rain? And three, what are they doing about dioxin and other toxins coming in from manufacturing processes? Stopping the small commercial fishermen from earning a living will not address the major problem facing the resource.
The proclamation requires all gill nets with a 2.5 to 5 inch mesh be attended at all times from sunset on Friday to sunrise on Monday through September the 7th in all internal coastal waters from the Albemarle Sound south to the state's southern border. A unique fundraiser was held to raise money for the Firefighters Burn Children's Relief Fund. Pamela Mamie was there.
The Dare Center in Kildevil Hills was the site for the first annual 4x4 show. The event brought in a little over $400 for the Firefighters Burned Children's Fund. Glenn Rainey of Kildevil Hills is vice president of the area chapter and a career firefighter.
The first of many, we hope. The weather's turned out to cooperate today on a beautiful Saturday afternoon. We've got trucks from all over Virginia and North Carolina. The show has worked out a lot better than we had hoped. We were scared of the weather, but it's cooperated with us. We've got more trucks than we had hoped for. We got a lot of people out here. We've got Dennis Anderson's Grave Digger and Dennis Anderson. He's been a big draw. We've got a lot of help from all the media and local fire departments. Collington Fire Department is represented with their four-wheel drive pumper. We've got trucks and people from all over, and especially a lot of people that have come down and seen the trucks and decided to come in and take a look at us.
23 4x4s were on display, with the farthest from Hopewell, Virginia. Area firefighters thank those of you who donated to the fund. Proceeds will be split between local fire prevention activities and the North Carolina J.C. Burn Center in Chapel Hill. Pamela Mamie reporting.
We'll be back with more news in a moment.
The folks at the Duchess of Dare restaurant invite you to join them for breakfast, lunch, and dinner daily. They feature an all-you-can-eat breakfast buffet on Saturday and Sunday, dinner buffet Tuesday through Saturday, and lunch buffet every Sunday. The Duchess of Dare also has a special children's menu, so mom and dad and the kids can all dine out at an affordable price. Located in historic downtown Mateo on Roanoke Island, enjoy a meal today, breakfast, lunch, or dinner at the Duchess of Dare restaurant.
Kellogg's True Value Home Centers in Mateo, Kildevil Hills, and Duck offer their customers a large variety of housewares, home furnishings, small appliances, and every hardware item or tool you could possibly need to get the job done. At each location, Kellogg's has building materials, too, to build anything, including your dream home. So the next time you begin a project, remember one name, Kellogg's True Value Home Centers, with three convenient locations, Highway 64 in Mateo, on the beach road at Milepost 9 in Kildevil Hills, and in Duck.
Fishing Unlimited is five reasons so many people come to the Outer Banks. It's fun for the whole family. It's the freshest seafood anywhere. It's fishing tackle. It's the Outer Banks Pier at Milepost 18 and a half in South Nags Head, and our Roanoke Sound Fishing and Crabbing Pier on the Nags Head Mateo Causeway. Two great piers for one price. There's also a trained staff on hand at both locations to assist you. They do all of that so you'll have all the memories at Fishing Unlimited.
Hi, I'm RV. At Keeper's Galley, we give you great value for your dollar.
Would you take a look at these eggs? I sure like to see the size of that big chicken. Now I ask you, how can anything that big be called a shrimp? And folks, this is what we call a real seafood platter. And our prime rib, it's as big as the state of Texas. And you know what we say?
RV?
Oh no, Mr. Buzz, not the spoon, please.
Welcome back. As a result of recent legislation passed by the North Carolina House of Representatives and the Senate, the insurance commissioner will now have more power to review, modify, set, approve, and disapprove rates for wind and hail insurance coverage, a factor that many people who live on the coast believe will save them money. Fletcher Willie, who is the president of the North Carolina Independent Insurance Agents, spoke with us about the change.
The whole process started about, during the last session of the legislature, when we saw the bill to revise the beach and fair plan dying, and we went to Senator Bassnight and told him that bill was in trouble. And he introduced legislation which would create a legislative research committee to study the operations of the beach and fair plan. The report of the legislative research committee recommended legislation which would empower the Commissioner of Insurance, one, to approve, disapprove, or modify any rates, rules, and procedures of the North Carolina Insurance Underwriting Association, which we know as the Beach Plan. This will allow the Commissioner to make improvements that will be much more responsive to the insuring public.
A couple of weeks ago, we featured a story from Crimeline. We had so much response to that story that we thought we'd take a more in-depth look at Crimeline. Pamela Mamie reports.
Crimeline of Dare County has been serving the Outer Banks since the early 1980s. Lieutenant Bill Walker of the Kill Devil Hills Police Department is law enforcement coordinator for Crimeline.
What we do is we pay money for information on crimes. We'll have 4 to 6 meetings a year with the board of directors of Crimeline, which is a total, if memory serves correct, is 18 members of the board of directors. And they're comprised of citizens, private citizens, all over the Dare County area.
Crimeline is an agency that gets financial support from the community. Those funds pay for expenses, such as rewards for information. Law enforcement officers of Crimeline meet and share information every week in Kill Devil Hills. Pamela Mamie reporting.
The annual Hermit Crab Race was held at Newman's Shell Shop this past week. It's an event that's popular with mom, dad, kids, grandma, and granddad. There were many people there. Everyone who participated received a prize, and the winner received the Golden Crab Award. Plus, there were gift certificates for the top 3 winners. This was the 16th year that the race was held. People came from as far away as Wisconsin. At one time, there was a bus service that ran from Hatteras Island to Manteo and back again. We're not sure of the date of this picture, but it shows the Hatteras to Manteo bus at its daily starting point at the Village Post Office in Hatteras, North Carolina. When we come back, we'll take a look at fishing.
The Manteo waterfront is indeed rich in history. Unlike today, commercial fishermen use sailing vessels called Sharpies to ply their trade. Clara's Seafood Grill and Steam Bar is proud of this heritage and is currently having a 20-foot scale model of a Sharpie built for display. Clara's carries a long family tradition of serving only the finest food available, excellently prepared and served, including their new steam bar. Awaiting you is a panoramic view of Shalabag Bay and the Elizabeth II, so chart your course for Clara's Seafood Grill.
This is Carl and Zena Hazer. You know the Hazers. They've invited everybody to see their new business, Nag's Head Florist. Carl and Zena arrange and deliver to their customers the freshest flowers available. With years of floral experience, they know what good service and quality products mean to their customers. So for that special occasion or a spur-of-the-moment flower that says I'm sorry or I love you, call Nag's Head Florist, 441-4861. Make Nag's Head Florist your florist of choice on the Outer Banks.
Let your dream soar at Kitty Hawk Kites. Since 1974, Kitty Hawk Kites has added adventure to the Outer Banks.
Kitty Hawk Kites has gifts for everyone, from whimsical to magical to fanciful. The largest selection of kites on the East Coast, with a trained staff to assist you in learning that kiting is a family sport. Famous t-shirt designs. Visit the new Flying Fish Camp, a true outdoor adventure wear store, at Kitty Hawk Kites, across from Jockey's Ridge in Nag's Head.
In the 1920s, the Midgets began their seafood business and have continued through four generations. At Midget Seafood Restaurant, you'll find a selection of delectable and skillfully prepared seafood and steaks. They take great pride in their food preparation using age-old family recipes. Your hosts, Jeffrey Gray Midget and his son Jeffrey Wade, know that using only the freshest seafood available combined with good service keeps their customers coming back time and again. Midget Seafood Restaurant, upholding a 75-year tradition.
Before we get to our fishing, there's a sports note. Registration for the Roanoke Island Soccer League is now underway through Monday, August the 17th at the Dare County Parks and Recreation Department in Manteo. They have three leagues to be formed, ages 6 through 9, 10 through 12, and kids 13 through 15 years of age. For more information, call 473-1101. Fishing in July and August offshore is traditionally a little slower than other times of the year. This year is no exception, but there have been a few nice fish caught. This is a picture of a big blue marlin that was caught out of the Oregon Inlet Fishing Center on board the Sportsman with Captain Omi Tillett. The fish weighed over 300 pounds. Back in the Sound, speckled trout fishing has been exceptional this year. These folks are fishing off what we call the Little Bridge. The proper name is the Melvin Daniels Bridge. You can tell by the number of people fishing and their enthusiasm that the fishing there for the trout has been pretty good. We had quite a few pictures come in from TW's Bait and Tackle this week. This first one is Patrick Jacobs of Kitty Hawk with a 75 and a half pound amberjack. Here's Russ Burge from Killdevil Hills with a 45 pound cobia. This is William Mariner from Elizabeth City. He's got a 39 and a half pound king mackerel. And this is Natalie Mazelle from Ahoskie, North Carolina. She's showing off her 68-pound cobia. Don't forget, if you have some fishing photos you'd like to share with us, you can send them to Carolina 92, 2402 Wrightsville Avenue, Nag's Head, North Carolina, 27959. And for the latest fishing reports, stay tuned to Carolina 92, WNHW 92.5 FM. Back in 1824, the first lightship was anchored on Diamond Shoals to warn mariners of the treacherous shallow waters. Life on board the lightships was not always easy. One was destroyed in 1827 by a hurricane. Another was sunk by the Germans during World War I on August the 6, 1918. This is a picture of one of the lightships anchored on Diamond Shoals. The lightships were replaced by a tower in 1966.
The Daniels family has been in the seafood business long enough to know what fresh means. At Fisherman's Wharf, they specialize in generous portions of the freshest seafood available, prepared to your liking. Enjoy the view of Wanchese Harbor, and on occasion, watch the boats unload their catch. But by all means, before you leave, stop by Cap'n Malk's Seafood Market and take some fresh seafood home for later. Fisherman's Wharf, home of good folks and great food.
Village Home Furnishings has the largest inventory of home furnishings on the Outer Banks. Let the professional staff of designers create an interior with brilliant colors of furniture, pictures, window treatments, and accessories for your beach cottage or home. After your choice has been made, let Village Home Furnishings deliver and set up your new furniture. Then all you need to do is show off your new home furnishings from Village Home Furnishings, milepost 11 on the bypass in Nag's Head or milepost 6 on the bypass in Killdevil Hills.
At Newman Seashell and Gift Shop, milepost 13 and a half on the beach road in Nag's Head, you can discover one of Nag's Head's oldest and finest traditions in shopping. Their collection of native and exotic seashells has grown into the largest exhibit on the Outer Banks. Newman's offers thousands of seashells, plus locally made gifts, jewelry, and unique souvenirs. Take time to experience what has attracted generations of beachgoers. Lots of seashells at low prices. At Newman Seashell and Gift Shop, milepost 13 and a half, Nag's Head.
You'll not find any better food or atmosphere than at the Pier House Restaurant, located on the Nag's Head Fishing Pier at Milepost 12. The Pier House restaurant opens at 6 a.m. with an affordable breakfast for the early riser. And for lunch, the Pier House restaurant offers both a hot or cold lunch special. For dinner, enjoy ordering from their dinner menu or one of their all-you-can-eat seafood specials. The Nag's Head Pier House restaurant, Milepost 12. Ocean View Dining, morning, noon, or night.
We're getting closer every day to the opening of the new jail in Dare County. Jim Mills spent a few minutes at the graduation exercises for the new jailers and also had the opportunity to take us on a tour of the jail.
It took 5 weeks of intensive training, but graduation ceremonies are taking place right now in this building.
Recently, COA's Dare campus was the site of graduation ceremonies for the jailers that will occupy the new $8.3 million facility. County officials in attendance included Commissioner Louise Dollard, Jail Commander Jack Cahoon, and Sheriff Burt Austin.
I'm very pleased that we've had such a good turnout. The grades were extremely well, and they've got a lot going for them by going off to these other jails to be interviewed and seeing how these other ones work. We're looking forward to having this new jail open as soon as we can and getting it underway.
Have you ever done anything like this before?
No, I used to be in retail, and getting into this is my first job in this line.
Judy, what was it like?
It was fun. A variety of experiences. We were really exposed to a lot of different areas of instruction.
Judy, I noticed there were 14 women graduate. Was it tougher on the women or about the same?
No, I don't think so. I think some sections of the instructions were harder on men and some on women.
This is the new $8.2 million facility, which is scheduled to open on September 4th. And this is where the graduates will spend a lot of their time.
Although the facility is not completed, we took a walking tour with Jack Cahoon.
Well, the way the jail is set up as an officer bringing in an arrestee, they will enter into a vehicle sally port, which is secure, and that's when the law enforcement will remove his gun, and then he'll take the inmate into the jail, and then it'll be processed by get the proper papers completed by the magistrates, and then will be processed. So you have a processing area where you get all the information, they're strip searched, put into their jail uniforms, given their bedding, and then taken to the cell block. We do have, before we carry them to the cell block, we do have holding cells to where they can be put in and be properly classified before we determine in what type of cells they will be put in, whether it be a minimum security, maximum security, or medium security area. Then you'll go down a hallway, which leads to, the jail has two separate jail sections, A and B, and they'll go down to the jail A section, which has the maximum, minimum, and the medium security area. As you go down that hallway, the first on the left is the maximum security, and that area will handle 24 inmates. When we talk about maximum security, we're talking about inmates that'll spend 23 hours a day in their cell and will be allowed 1 hour outside of the cell into the cell block where they can take a shower or exercise or do what they want to within their own cell block. Medium security is an area where they're locked down, but doors can be open and they can move about in the area, like when they eat or when they just want to lounge around type thing. The minimum security is an area where you do not have cell doors. They're open, more like a barrack type area with individual rooms, and with an open area where they're allowed to roam about. That usually is the type of people that would be work release or what they call inmate trustees or inmate workers.
Do you have any outside facilities, basketball courts, anything like that?
There is one outside area entirely for women and two for the men in each cell jail area. They're high walled with steel toppings, screen toppings, and it really isn't a basketball area. It's just an open concrete area with a wall where there will be a basketball if they want to shoot, or more or less it's just to give an opportunity to get out and get fresh air more than anything else.
Construction is scheduled to be completed in early September. I'm Jim Mills reporting.
Looks like a pretty nice place, but I hope you don't have to spend any time there. Thank you, Jim. I was visiting the Outer Banks History Center this past week, and there's an exhibit there that I thoroughly enjoyed. I'd like to recommend it to you and your family. It's called An Artist Catch by Frank Stick, watercolors of fish from all over the world. You'll find it entertaining and educational. The center is located on Ice Plant Island in Manteo.
Why do so many people come back to eat at the Dunes restaurant? Maybe it has something to do with the great food, priced so that you can afford to take the whole family. The Dunes has a breakfast bar, lunch, and dinner specials, early bird dinner specials, and a fantastic salad bar. So bring the whole family to the Dunes. It's a local favorite. Oh yeah, don't forget your hat and t-shirt from the Dunes restaurant too. The Dunes, milepost 16 and a half, Nag's Head.
Dennis Anderson and the Gravedigger is a real crowd pleaser as he travels the world as the Monster Truck Champion. Based on the Outer Banks, the Gravedigger 4x4 Center is located on Westlake Drive in Killdevil Hills. So while you're on vacation, stop by and see how monster trucks are put together to compete on the monster truck circuit. And be sure to pick up a Gravedigger t-shirt or hat so when you get back home, you can say,
"Hey, I saw the Gravedigger while on vacation on the Outer Banks."
Yo, this here's old Ralph from Macon Tracks. It's the 9.5 mile post on the bypass in Killdevil Hills. Hey, come on down to Macon Tracks where they have the only fully automated 2-minute car wash on the Outer Banks. And while you're there, fill up with Exxon gasoline, hey, get some ice and your favorite beverages, or try a couple of them world-famous hot dogs fixed just the way you like it. Pick up some suntan oil, sunglasses, or beach accessories. It's all at Macon Tracks. They've got everything to make a great day at the beach. And hey, when you get there, tell them Ralph sent you.
Nag's Head Hammocks, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Killdevil Hills and milepost 10.5 on the beach road at Nag's Head, has handcrafted woven hammocks and leisure furniture made on the premises. Nag's Head Hammocks has that unique gift or that special accent of leisure furniture for your beach cottage or home. With shipping of any product, Nag's Head Hammocks assures you of quality, durability, and workmanship of all their products. Nag's Head Hammocks, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Killdevil Hills and milepost 10.5 on the beach road in Nag's Head.
Seafood prepared the Etheridge way. That's what the Etheridge Seafood Restaurant is all about. Recipes handed down from one generation of Etheridges to another. Seafood fried or broiled, blackened dishes prepared and served in a variety of ways. And new from the Etheridge menu is seafood pizza, served with red or white sauce. And from the Irene Etheridge cookbook, seafood egg rolls that are an award-winning recipe. The Etheridge Seafood Restaurant, milepost 9.5 on the bypass in Killdevil Hills. Fresh seafood prepared the Etheridge way.
This past week, they had the annual pony roundup at Chincoteague Island. Well, that's not the only place they've had pony roundups. Years ago, they used to have pony roundups on Ocracoke Island. Here's a picture that was taken in 1939. It shows the ponies of Ocracoke being penned up. It was done partially to raise money, but also as a tourist attraction for the island. Thank you for watching. Have a good evening.